of millions of voices. One man will become many.
We are not alone out here.
Listen to my story.
I have a bad feeling about this.
What?
Great Scott!
No need to panic.
Very
Captain
funny.
Jack
Just
Sparrow.
Your friendly if neighborhood Spider-Man.
We get it, blah, blah, blah.
Get ready for an adventure unlike any you've ever seen.
What is that?
Or heard.
My delicate ears can't take it no more.
Prepare yourself for laughter.
Tears.
And moments of neither. Get set for the voice to end all voices. The master of mouth. The king of characterization. The prince of pronunciation. The infinite impersonator. The architect of audibles. The noun of nouns. The one. The only. Is anybody buying this yet? Ladies and gentlemen. The best of the best. Please help me welcome to the stage every voice you've heard and will hear, including this one, is... James Arnold Taylor!
Whoa! Hey! How are ya? My name is James Arnold Taylor, and I am a voice actor. I've been very fortunate to be the voice of characters like Fred Flintstone, Johnny Test, and, of course, Obi-Wan Kenobi. But how did it all begin? Well, for me, it was a long time ago. In a studio far, far away. But what is a voice actor? Well, basically, someone who spends their time in a little padded room talking to themselves. But today, you're gonna come with me inside that booth and behind the scenes of my life. So you're ready for that, yeah? Well, I gotta tell you, having a Jedi Knight as your alter ego, you know, it can have its privileges. For example, if I need a hand today, I simply say, "Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope."
Yes, James, I'm here. My scanners are detecting a vast amount of life forms with you. Welcome, everyone. Now, as the voice of reason in James's head, I shall do my best to keep him mindful.
Oh, of the Force?
No, the time. Move along, James. Move along.
Move along, James. Move along. Move along, James. Man, he gets me with that every time, you know? Well, okay, so for me, it was always about voices and sounds. By the time I was 4 years old, I decided I would be an entertainer and do voices. So I started by studying very hard by watching a lot of cartoons, yeah. Oh, and reading comic books. I'd even create my own comics and my own hero. My hero was the sound. He'd use sound waves to create alternate realities for the bad guys. As a kid, it kind of sounded like...
I have control of all the sounds you hear. I fight crime and pursue justice. I am the sound, the sound, the sound, the sound, the sound, the sound.
Yeah, but you know, thank you. It gets better, trust me. Because in my head, it sounded more like...
What we hear can be our reality. I have control of the frequencies. I can manipulate them if I will. Bending, stretching, and if necessary, breaking the boundaries of all you hear.
Such a challenge. You will hear what arrives.
Evildoers, beware! I will find you. I will bring you to justice. As you know, this sound is that of Jesus. I am the sound.
much more dramatic in a little kid's head, I gotta tell you. Oh boy. So, okay. I worked really hard at that point to make the same voice I heard in my head come out of my mouth. And, you know, I became a student of voice, but I really wanted to know exactly where voiceover began. Now, what I found was...
voiceover. Since the dawn of time, man used his voice to entertain. Which didn't always go over well. The first great leap in communicating and entertaining to the masses was the invention of...
radio. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. WJAT Radio brings you all the entertainment that's fit to voice. Yes, radio is comedy.
Well, who's on first? What's on second? I don't know who's on third.
So who's playing first?
Yes.
I mean the fella's name.
Who?
The fella playing first base.
Who is on first?
Well, what are you asking me for? Drama.
I love you, Margot. And I love you, Chad, but...
there's someone else, isn't there?
No, Chad.
No? Then why don't you tell me who this is?
Hello, Margot.
Sports!
The champ is looking to be in bad shape. The challenger's got him on the ropes. He's giving him a left and a right and a left and a right and still another left and another right.
Music, baby, as sweet can be, like sugar from a candy tree, honey kisses from the vine.
News. Dateline, Europe, 1945. The German high command surrender their forces to the Allies. Hitler's minions have given up the fight.
And suspense.
I'm telling you, whatever you do, do not open that door.
But I must see.
Trust me, nothing can prepare you for what is on the other side.
But I must.
Hello, Margot. But radio was only the beginning. Voiceover is used in everything from film.
Critics are calling it so-so. Not one of this year's best.
From the director of a big movie that did really well and the producers of a movie that did really well comes...
a story that will touch your heart and make you believe your darkest fears will come true.
To television.
Tonight's presentation is brought to you in living color.
Butter.
Got milk.
Oh yeah!
We are experiencing technical difficulties. Please stand by.
To phone services.
If you'd like to make a call, please hang up and dial again.
What kind of movie would you like to see?
Computers. You've got mail.
Even video games.
See ya!
Announcers have come in all shapes, sizes, and styles. It's Wrestle Mayhem! This is your nightly news. Here's Johnny.
Ask your doctor if breathing is right for you. It's a new car. Be sure to get your parents' permission before going online.
Live from New York, it's Saturday night.
Burger, fries, and acid. Leave me alone. I'm queasy.
Voiceover. Wherever there are words needing to be read, there will be a voice actor ready to read them from now into the next millennium and beyond.
For me, voices really became my density. Destiny, that's what it is. Yeah, okay, so, you know, I loved classic cartoons. I would watch them every morning before going to school. I'd study the inflections, the tones, the characters, and I'd say it all right along with them as I watched.
Shh,
be very, very quiet. I'm hunting wabbits.
What's up, Doc? I'll tell you what's up. It's wabbit season. Duck season. Wabbit season. Wabbit season. Duck season. Fire!
Where's the kaboom? There was supposed to be an earth-shattering kaboom.
I thought I saw a putty cat.
Suffering fuckatash.
I don't like tea. It gives me a headache.
Fourth floor, clock, socks, bagels, and locks. Watch your step.
Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Wile E. Coyote, super genius.
Meep, meep.
Meanwhile, at the Hall of Justice,
Wonder Twin powers activate.
Oh boy. Gosh.
Yeah, I could never actually talk like Donald, but I could sneeze like him, which was good, you know? Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. But you know, it wasn't just cartoons that did great voices. There were puppets that did them as well, remember?
Oh, hey, Bert.
Now, some of which sounded a lot like other puppets.
Oh, hello, Bert.
Yeah, but see, it didn't matter, right? They were awesome. Oh, and by the way, Kermit singing Rainbow Connection could pretty much bring the biggest bully on the playground to tears and save me from his wrath. Why are there so many songs about rainbows and what's on the other side?
It's so true.
The lovers, the dreamers, and me. That's always good for me to learn voices, right? You know, in fact, even though I was always the smallest kid in my class, you know, I didn't really get picked on. I found that my mimicry, it kind of helped me, you know? I'd recreate what everybody saw on their favorite TV shows the night before. If I went and saw a movie, it was like I had a copy of it in my head that I could go back and rewind and reenact. And, you know, this was before the internet, YouTube, DVDs, DVRs. VCRs were brand new back then, and they cost like $1 million. So, you know, basically I was TiVo. You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind.
Flight calm, I can't hold it. I can't hold it. She's breaking up.
Steve Austin, astronaut. A man barely alive.
Gentlemen, we can rebuild him.
Does your dog bite?
No.
I thought you said your dog doesn't bite.
That's not my dog.
You're gonna need a bigger boat.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Kit, get us out of here.
I'm sorry, Michael. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Bond. James Bond. Snakes. Why did it have to be snakes?
E.T. Phone home. Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop up the ground once in a while, you can miss it.
Your powers are weak, old man.
You can't win, Darth. If you strike me down, I will become more powerful than you can possibly imagine.
Whoa, wait a second, Doc. Are you telling me that you built a time machine out of a DeLorean?
The way I see it, if you're gonna build a time machine into a car, why not do it with some style? Besides, the stainless steel construction made the flux dispersal absolute. Look out!
Whoa, is this heavy? That's fun. I like that. Okay, so now at the age of 16, I took all this talking to myself to the stage as a stand-up comic. At 17, I got into radio and became a DJ, and by the time I was in my 20s, I had built my own home studio and started my own voiceover production company. One of my first clients was Movie Phone. Now, no, I was not Mr. Movie Phone. I was actually the friendly voice that told you about all the theater locations and where the most convenient parking was so you wouldn't get towed. Yeah, I also did their trailers. And one time, they wanted me to create this trailer for Jurassic Park 2. It was about to come out. The only problem was, they didn't have any of the sound from the movie yet. And so I was like, well, okay, what can I do? They asked me to do it, so I used what I had. My voice, right? Oh, and my lunch. Yeah, I had some chips, and I had my drink. And I took these, and I thought, okay, well, I need to create that chest thing there. That'll help with the footsteps, right? If I go, then I took my cup and I pitched my voice way down with a vocal processor, so it got really deep and low. Something like that.
Yeah, that's pretty good. So I did that. I took these, and then.
Thank you. seemed to work. Yeah.
James, are you all right? I thought I heard the Zillow Beast.
No, Master Konomi, it's just me talking to myself, you know? Yeah.
Good. I was going to say...
Oh, you have a bad feeling about this?
Yes. Yeah. But I believe there's a quota on that line in this show, and I want to save it for when it really matters.
Good idea. Good idea. Okay, well, you know, actually, that dinosaur is a good demonstration of multi-track recording, which I do all the time in the studio as a voice actor. Now, multi-track recording is playing several tracks all at once, and you got EQ and reverb and all that stuff, and it creates, it's how you make music, it's how you make sound in films. And, you know, in the old days, we had these big two-track tape players and eight-track tape players, and we would cut with razor blades and grease pencils. Now it's pretty much a keystroke on the computer. So I thought I'd give you a demonstration of multi-track recording using, well, why don't we use this music right here that you hear, play it, see? That music is actually just my voice. There's no instruments in it. But let me break it down for you now and show you how we did it. So if we cut that one out and just, we'll start with one track, right? So I'd loop that, then I make another track, a bass. Boom, 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 boom. Loop that one, now make another one with a little rhythm. Boom, 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 boom. Loop that one, make another one. Boom, 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 boom. Loop that one, let's do a deeper one, right? Loop that one, put another one up there, make a higher one. Right? So you get the idea, we had another track there and another one. All we need now is a melody, so... Scoop-dap-da, scoop-dap-da-da-da, scoop-dap-da, scoop-dap-da-da-da, scoop-dap-da-da-da. Come on, you know the scoop. Da da, scoop da da da. Come on, da da, scoop da da da. It's gonna get stuck in your head. Da da da. Scoop da da. So we add all this sound and EQ and reverb and all these cool things. We've got all these tracks, and really, it's all simply been just one guy making all that noise. So I learned the tools of my trade, and I really loved what I was doing, and I knew what I really wanted to do, though, was be a voice actor. So what I did was I put a demo together. I got that out there wherever I could, got it to agents, and after a few years of persistence, I finally got an agent. You know, some of my first work was doubling Michael J. Fox for things like Stuart Little and Milo Thatch in Atlantis, The Lost Empire. I even got to take over for Milo in the sequel, for Michael as Milo in the sequel, Atlantis Milo's Return, which is now available on Disney DVD. They pay me to say that. Anyways, but you know, it wasn't all overnight. No. Voiceover takes a lot of work, a lot of hard work, a lot of persistence, and a lot of auditioning. Now, in the audition process, this is your chance to show the writers, the directors, the producers that you're the right person for the job. And so you put it out there the best you can, and they're going to put you through your paces always. And you never quite know in an audition what to expect.
Okay, James, make yourself comfortable. We want you to sound very real, casual, conversational. We're looking to get this in about 1.7 seconds. Oh, and don't make it too announcery. For this first take, just give us whatever you have in mind, okay?
Okay, great.
Great, we're rolling, take one.
Use only as directed.
Great, okay, let's try one a little more conversational.
Use only as directed.
Now more serious.
Use only as directed.
What if we needed it in 3.8 seconds instead of 1.7?
Use only as directed.
Okay, now stretch it out, but go back to 1.7 seconds.
Use only as directed.
How about with a German accent?
Use only as directed.
No.
New York, maybe?
Use only as directed, eh?
British?
Use only as directed.
How about French?
Use only as directed.
Romanian?
Directed, use only as.
What would a woman sound like?
Use only as directed.
Whispering?
Use only as directed.
Yeah, more staccato.
Use only as directed.
How about a real announcery voice?
Use only as directed.
Now energize it.
Use only as directed.
Bigger and faster.
Use only as directed.
Faster and bigger.
Use only as directed.
Bigger.
Use only as directed.
Okay, stand by. Sounds real good, James. You know, we're actually thinking we're gonna go with your first take. Thanks for coming in.
Now you know why it's a padded room. I've really come a long way in my career as a voice actor. And one of the things I never would have imagined I would have been doing when I was a kid, when I knew I wanted to be a voice actor, was video games, you know? Because as a kid, video games looked more like, what are you gonna do, right? You know, you know, there's that. I mean, like, oh, okay, let me just, oh, no, I missed. Oh, they're coming down really in single file lines. It's weird. Okay, let me just, let me go. Oh, no, okay. Whoa, 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 this is fun. All right, okay, how do I stop it? How do I, whoa! Not much there. Yeah. So, you know, but nowadays, they've changed a bit, and I've been very fortunate to be the voice of some pretty cool characters, like, of course, Ratchet from Ratchet & Clank, Tidus from Final Fantasy X, your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man, Great Scott, Young Doc Brown,
Captain Jack Sparrow,
Willy Wonka,
Prince Charming,
Gingy the Gingerbread Man,
the voice of Minions,
and Fallen Transformers.
Wow, you know, it's very cool. But video game work can be some of the most strenuous work you can do as a voice actor. It really is. Why? Well, because there's so many different places you can go, and if you turn this way, it's that, and that, and the other, and there's so many ways to get hurt, get hit, or die.
Okay, James, we need some fighting and death sounds from you. First, you're getting punched. Now you're the one doing the punching. Great. Now you're jumping. And landing. Give a laugh when you jump. But you're sad when you land. You're falling off a single-story roof. How about two stories? Now off a huge cliff, never to be seen again. You're being electrocuted. Add some more jitter to it. And some futzing. Yeah, it's less painful and more bizarre. You're being riddled with machine gun fire. Ooh, hey, speaking of fire, now you're on fire. Okay, now let's do a combo. You've been kicked in the gut, picked up, thrown off a three-story building, and landed in a pit of fire. You jump out and are electrocuted. You save yourself by jumping into some water, but then realize there's a sea monster in it, and it tries to eat you, but then spits you out, and you're okay after all. All right. That was a great rehearsal. Now let's take it from the top and actually record this one. You guys ready?
So while I do most of my work from my home studio these days, being a voice actor does require a lot of running around. You know, because we're heard but not seen, we can be many different people in many different locations throughout a single day. I could start my day driving off to Burbank to do the voice of one of my favorite reoccurring characters, the Strawberry Mini Wheat. Hey guys, a little family reunion, huh? Then drive way over the hill to Santa Monica to audition for the roles of Guy 1, Guy 2, and Guy 3. Oh, and an announcer that shouldn't sound like an announcer. Oh, and Guy 1 should have the same tonal qualities of Guy 3, but not the same as Guy 2. But Guy 2 should have a similar read as Guy 1, but not the same as Guy 3. Then I drive over to Studio City to re-record a line of dialogue I did a year earlier due to a change from standards and practices. This is called ADR, or Additional Dialogue Replacement.
Poop.
Phooey. Then I drive back to my home studio to patch in on the ISDN line for a quick promo for Fox.
Animation Domination's all new Sunday, 7, 6 Central on Fox.
Okay, see, an ISDN is a phone patch that allows me to patch into any studio anywhere in the world and sound like I'm right there with them. The only problem is there's a delay in your voice when you talk. So, everything you say has a delay, You know, it's like when you watch the news and the reporter is via satellite. There's those awkward pauses as they wait for the words to reach them, you know? I mean, this could be breaking news, a reporter with urgent information from somewhere on the other side of the planet, but once they ask him a question...
It still takes him a couple of seconds to respond.
So it does take a little getting used to. Okay, so then I'm over the hill and yabba dabba do it in Hollywood as everybody's favorite caveman.
Bonnie, my pebbles!
Then I drive over to Century City to do what we call a tag, also known as... That voice that comes on at the end of the commercial and says a bunch of stuff you can never understand because it's talking so fast. Offer expires November 30th. See store for details. Batteries not included. Action figures sold separately. Summons never required. Member FDIC. Use only as directed. Then I fight LA traffic to make all my way home to start all over again the next day. All in a day's work for a voice actor. Oh. So you can see, there are different types of voice acting and voice actors and ways of recording. You know, if you're doing a show like, well, say The Clone Wars, an animated show, you're usually in the studio with the rest of the cast, reading all together like an old-time radio play.
Look, it's Kenobi.
What? No, I...
Master Obi-Wan, look out!
Freeze, Jedi scum.
I have a bad feeling about this. If you're doing an animated feature film, you're all alone in the studio with just the director giving you the lines to react to.
Scene 4, take 9. Please, don't leave me. You mean everything to me.
And you mean everything to me. I love you.
Oh, and I love you too. And cut.
Yeah, you know, you may never even meet your co-stars. As a voice actor, I have worked with some of Hollywood's biggest names, and I gotta tell you, rarely are we in a room together, or do we even meet. If you're doing a radio commercial, though, you might be in with the other actors.
Hey, Bob, what's wrong?
Oh, it's this headache.
Well, here, try this.
Use only as directed.
Hey, that's my line. Now, okay, so now if you're doing a narration, you're alone. Promo or trailer, alone. A video game, alone again, naturally, yeah. You also have to know your tools, your equipment, the microphone and the headphones. You can't get into the studio and be startled by the sound of your own voice in the headphones.
That's me. I sound so high-pitched.
Okay, you see, generally, we all hear ourselves differently than everybody else because we're hearing it bigger, beefier, with more bass because we're hearing it from our own heads and not just our ears.
Hey, baby. Yeah, that's more like it.
So you can't be surprised when you hear yourself and then move away from the microphone to not be so loud. Oh, and speaking of loud, you can't wear loud clothing, like a finely starched shirt, a leather jacket, or pants, jingly jewelry, or worst of all, squeaky shoes. You can't have a smacky mouth or plosive P's, T's, or B's, or sibilant S's.
S.
And when you say words that start with those letters, slightly turn your head away from the mic, or you can hold a pencil in front of your mouth, which you can also use as a sound effect for chattering teeth, which is appropriate because most studios are freezing. Just look, don't be too close to the mic, but also not too far. If you're gonna yell, slightly move away. If you're gonna whisper, you lean in a little. You just have to know and enjoy the dance with your partner, the microphone.
Well done, James. No doubt all that experience prepared you for your greatest voice challenge.
Oh yeah, Fred Flintstone, great story. So,
No.
Oh, Johnny Test?
No. I was referring to a certain Jedi.
Oh, duh. Yeah, Plo Koon, of course. How could I forget?
So between you and Anakin, why do I bother?
Yeah. Okay, so, well, for those of you that don't know, which I would find hard to believe in this room, Plo Koon is another Jedi in the Star Wars universe, and I am the fortunate actor that gets to give him a voice on Star Wars The Clone Wars. This is a great honor for me for many reasons, mainly, though, because our supervising director, Dave Filoni's favorite character is Plo Koon. You know, now the direction Dave gave me when coming up with the voice was one word, Gandalf. Yeah, he wanted that Ian McKellen sound, you know? And with a voice like that, it's hard to not sound important. I mean, in fact, it's said that a great thespian could read just about anything and make it sound dramatic, exciting, compelling, you know, from, let's say, like, I don't know, like stereo instructions to, the phone book.
Smith. John. 316. Willowbrook Lane. 5. 5-5. 4-2. 3-1. Stereo speaker installation. Waltz connecting the left and right speaker interfaces. One must be certain to make the connections properly. For if the cords are not firmly plugged in, no sound shall pass!
So for Plo, I give it my best, Ian McKellen, and then sound design geniuses Matthew Wood and David Acor give it their best, and with a bit of
pitching and processing, a Jedi Master's voice is born.
You know, on Clone Wars alone, I get to be so many different characters besides just Obi-Wan and Plo Koon. And in the clip you're about to see, every single voice you hear is me. And if I've done my job right, you may have never known. Enjoy.
We can do this the difficult way or the simple way. The choice is yours.
Hey, what's this? What are you reaching for?
Stand down!
You can't take us all, Jedi.
Would you like to try and prove your theory?
Start the machine. Time for the Jedi to meet with his fatal accident.
That's your pleasure.
Can I help you?
May I help you?
Yes, what seems to be the problem?
Hey, what are you doing here? Get out of here, I'm about to take off!
I'm celebrating the death of a Jedi.
I killed Obi-Wan Kenobi.
So, how was my funeral?
Your Jedi resolve only delays the inevitable. Take them to interrogation. Torture them slowly. These are transitions. You're going to release us and hunt us down for sport.
Try and keep up, clone.
Hi-yah! This one was faster than most. I've lost the scent.
You're looking a little too young to be a Jedi. Yeah.
A thousand apologies, young one.
Regret. I report that my fleet will no longer be able to provide protection for the troops on Ryloth.
Senator Chuchi, you are given the authority to negotiate a peaceful settlement between the sovereign planet of Pantora and the Tals.
Oh well, just another boring day saving the universe.
May the Force be with you.
Hey, thank you. Yeah, just me in a little padded room. Talking to myself. Yeah, okay, so this can really put you to the test, or for me, it puts me to the Johnny test, yeah. Now, on the show Johnny Test, I play 11-year-old Johnny, whose genius twin sisters use as their test subject. Well, it's great fun to be Johnny, but it does require some vocal acrobatics, all of which I have to do right in front of this mic without a lot of movement. I mean, even if I get turned into a fish and beat up by an angry dolphin. Yeah, it's my voice that has to tell the whole story. And that's the thing for a voice actor when they step into a booth. Not to feel crazy and restricted, but to feel free and limitless. So, I can voice Johnny and many other characters on the show without restrictions.
Imagine a voiceover that can actually turn a boring old day into an exciting movie. Stand back, citizens, for this looks like a job for Johnny X.
Johnny X, I, Dark Vegan, will destroy you.
Man, is it hard to breathe with this thing on.
And you'll need some help from me, Mr. Mittens.
And me, the beekeeper!
Help!
Pork Belly is under attack by bad guys. But who are these super evil villains, and where in the world is Johnny X to save us? More on that after a word from our sponsor.
I'm Doc Beetle. Try my piles of honey balls.
So are you guys gonna, like, take over the universe or the world or something?
Don't know yet. We're kicking around some ideas.
Ooh, I like Johnny's suggestion of taking over the world. Anyone else taking over the world?
You know, on second thought, let's just leave all the voice acting to James Arnold Taylor, huh?
It appears no voice can contain you, James. Well done. I do find it hard to believe that voice comes from the same throat as mine, but...
It's really true, and it's really awesome!
Oh my. I must see a medical droid about this.
Yeah.
Carry on, James.
Okay, Obi-Wan. Yeah, I hope he's okay, though, because I was gonna just start to share with y'all how I came to get the role of Obi-Wan Kenobi. See, back in 2002, when I first auditioned for the micro-series of The Clone Wars, I had no idea what I was reading for. I was surprised and humbled to get the job, and the coolest part was I got to voice him in so many other things, like the Revenge of the Sith video game. Now, the movie was being made at the same time, so I got to see a lot of it as it was being made, which was really cool. And the one thing they asked me to do at Lucas was to match Ewan McGregor's voice as closely as I could. And I remember recreating one specific scene from the film for the game that I'm told is what really locked me in as his voice double. It's my favorite scene.
You are the chosen one! It was said that you would destroy the Sith, not join them. Bring balance to the Force, not leave it in darkness. You are my brother, Anakin. I loved you.
So what I do now is I really do my best to combine and pay proper tribute to both the amazing Sir Alec Guinness.
These aren't the droids you're looking for.
And the fantastic Ewan McGregor.
I have a bad feeling about this.
Now, you know, look, I will admit that sometimes I like to combine other characters with Obi-Wan Kenobi and other films. It happens. Well, for example, you know, one of my favorite scenes is Christopher Walken in Pulp Fiction when he's given that gold watch to a young Bruce Willis. It reminds me of a scene in Star Wars, A New Hope.
Hello, little man. Boy, I sure heard the Force is strong with you. You see, I was a good friend of your father's, Anakin. We were in that Clone Wars battle together over 5 years, which reminds me, Luke, I got something for you. This lightsaber I got here was your father's. He wanted you to have it when you were old enough, but your uncle wouldn't allow it. I guess he thought you might go and follow old Obi-Wan on some crazy idealistic crusade. You know. See, this is a weapon of a Jedi Knight. Not as clumsy or random as a blaster. An elegant weapon for a more civilized age. Your father wore this lightsaber every day he was in that war. The saber was on your daddy's belt when he was shot down over this Tatooine. He was captured and put in a Huttese prison camp. He knew if the slugs ever got the saber, it'd be confiscated, taken away. The way your dad looked at it, this saber was his birthright. He'd be damned if Jabba was gonna get his slimy fat hands on his boy's birthright, so he hid it in the one place he knew he could hide something, his R2 unit. For 5 long years, he hid this lightsaber in his R2 unit. Fortunately, your daddy's luck ran out when he was killed, along with all the other Jedi, after the Order 66. You see, a young Jedi by the name of Darth Vader, who was a pupil of mine before he turned to the dark side, betrayed and murdered your father. Just before he died, he gave me the lightsaber. I hid this uncomfortable hunk of metal in my R2 unit for many years. And now, little Luke, I give the lightsaber to you. The Force will be with you, always.
Thank you.
You know, good old Obi-Wan Kenobi is what I call him. Yeah, you know, I got to double Christopher Walken once in a video game, and I heard later that a review came out and said that Walken was great in the game. So I took that as a compliment that I did all right, you know? It's really cool. In my work as a voice actor, I get to double a lot of celebrities when they're not available to do their own voice in video games or toys or sometimes even the films. And one of my favorite people to double for, who is just a fantastic actor, is Johnny Depp. And I have got to double for him in his regular speaking voice as Jack Sparrow, Willy Wonka, the Mad Hatter. And I'm told that when I did this stuff for Willy Wonka, the video game, he had a CD of my work when he was making Pirates that he would listen to, and if he heard anything he didn't like or wanted me to change, he asked for my cell number and my home number, and he wanted to call me. I mean, how cool is that, right? You know? And unfortunately, though, he didn't ever call, much to my wife's chagrin, but... Well, we told you guys to turn these off. You don't... Should I? Okay. Hello? Hello?
Hey, Taylor. It's Leary.
Dennis Leary?
Hello, that's what I said, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, no, I was expecting Johnny Depp. We were just talking.
Depp what? I didn't know you had a bigger name on the other line.
No. I was talking about an impression of him that I do.
Yeah, well, newsflash, Obi-Wan Kenobi. The impression of me that you do stinks, okay?
Oh, okay, the impression I do of you stinks. Okay,
very funny.
Funny.
Very funny.
Oh, yeah, very funny, very funny. No,
now,
not it. No.
Loser.
Stinko.
Huh? Okay, that last one wasn't bad.
Okay, good. Yeah, thank
you. You know, but the truth is, you're really going to be sorry that you're doing this. You know why?
Oh, am I really going to be sorry I'm doing
this? I'm not Dennis Leary. I'm actually Johnny Depp.
What?
Yeah, I thought it'd be fun to fool you. I was working on my Dennis Leary impression. What do you think?
It was very good, sir. Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
You know, the truth is, James, you do my voice really pretty well, but, you know, there's somebody else that actually does it much better than you. Do you know who that is?
No, who?
Gilbert Gottfried, because it's actually Gilbert doing Johnny Depp right now.
Oh, sure, I've been punked by Bill Gilbert Gottfried.
It's me on the phone with me.
Yeah.
It's like a Twilight Zone episode where someone steals the vocal cords of someone else and then they use it to make prank calls on the person who lost their voice. But you know, the joke is really on you, James, because it's not Dennis Leary or Johnny Depp or even me, Gilbert Gottfried.
No.
It's actually you.
Me?
Yeah, it's you or me, James. Yeah.
Wait a second. How can you be me and I be you and we're on the same...
So, what'd you think of the Dennis Leary, though? That's a new one I've been working on.
Oh, it's pretty good, actually. Yeah, I like that, yeah. Okay. Well, look, I gotta go. I'm doing a show right here, okay?
Yeah, okay. Oh, hey, if you're coming home, can you stop and get some cereal? I'm starving.
Cereal. Okay, great. All right, I'll see you later, or me.
Okay, yeah. See you, me, later.
See you, me, go.
Have
okay, all right. Okay, you
Bye-bye.
Too. Bye. All right, we're not doing... Okay, I'm sorry. Oh, it was weird. Boy. Oh, well, this is what goes on in the mind of a voice actor with too many voices running around in his head, I guess. You know, but, I mean, you know, actually, having a Jedi Knight that's very tidy living in your head and a very messy caveman is kind of like having, well, like the Odd Couple living inside me. And, you know, they're always fighting to see which one I'll do more of, you know? It's a battle of sounds. It's a war of tone. Yeah, you know what? It's a tone war. That's what it is.
Vocal cords divided. Obi-Wan Kenobi and Fred Flintstone are forced to live together under one roof. Can a Jedi Knight and a caveman live together without driving each other crazy?
Please, use the fork.
Yeah, brother.
Eating that won't help James's voice, Fred. Let it go. Let it go.
You've turned James's voice against me.
You have done that yourself.
You will not take it from me.
Your anger and your lust for power have already done that. You have allowed this hunger to twist your mind until now. Until now, you've become the very thing James's voice doesn't need.
Don't lecture me, Obi. I use James's voice same as you. I don't fear his lower register. I brought peace, freedom, and fruit delicious cereal of my new empire.
Bonnie!
Your new empire?
Don't make me clobber you.
Fred, my allegiance is to James's voice, to enunciating!
If you're not with me, then you're my enemy.
Only a caveman deals in absolutes. I will do what I must.
You will try. Yeah, Obi! Wilma!
I have failed you, Fred. I have failed you.
I should have known you were plotting to take over James's voice.
Fred, James's voice is to be shared!
From my point of view, there's no room to share.
Well, then you are lost!
This is the end for you, Obi Schmoby.
It's over, Fred! I have the high ground!
You underestimate my power.
Don't try it.
Yeah, but that, but no!
Looks as though you're all wet, Flintstone.
Okay, so being a voice actor and doing all these different voices through the years, I've come to find that, well, basically all voices are tones. And basically, you can get from one tone to the next by, you know, adding a little depth or giving a little texture, raising up the pitch or throwing in an accent. Let me give you an example. Well, look, let's just start with my regular voice, okay? Right, my regular voice, hang on. No, okay. So if we start somewhere about here, right, we'll find that there are many voices that are very similar to mine. One that I recently discovered, which I love doing, is Michael Emerson from Lost. You remember, he played Benjamin Linus, and he had such a way of talking that everything said sounded a little creepy and just a little off. Now, if you take the creep out and make it a little more folksy and friendly, you get Ron Howard. Lose the folk and give it some soul, and now it's Justin Timberlake, and it's becoming like a social network of voices. Use some wizardry in a British accent, you get Daniel Radcliffe.
Lay it back, give it a little twang, you get yourself Matthew McConaughey. Who, if you flip over, it becomes Heath Ledger as the Joker, and he completes me.
Shift it over just a little and you get Christian Slater,
who, if you drop down in tone, is Jack Nicholson.
You raise that back up and seem less interested, it's David Spade, and you are,
oh, I'm McLovin, and I totally sound like, well, oh, wait a second, Doc, it's me again, so let's drop it down in tone, and you get Shia LaBeouf. Well, wait a second, Optimus, you mean to tell me that my car is a robot? Oh, I gotta tell you, this is, like, you know, unbelievable, you know? I gotta go tell Sandy, because it's crazy the way these voices intertwine, you know? And the way I break up my sentence structure is not that dissimilar to a smarter than the average man. Hey, Ruffy boy, Ruffy boy. Hey, Freddy, you know there, Sammy. To properly connect the voices there, you just gotta shirty, burny, hurdy, gurdy, burny, burny, shirty.
Gunga, the Gunga. Gunga, the Gunga. You talking to me, huh? You talking to me, Gunga, the Gunga? If I'm curt with you, I'm sorry. It's just, I love you, Spartacus. Oh, and I love me too.
Wait a minute, dum-dum, you sound like me.
All right, nobody panic.
Panic's my middle name. You and me both.
Oh, Yogi, I'm gonna tell Mr. Ranger and he's gonna have to come and make an offer and come and feel, huh? Oh, yeah, like a Kansas spinach.
Well, blow me down and hoo-ha, okay? You ever notice Al Pacino's slowly turning into Jim Ignatowski from Taxi? Okay, okay. I mean, great Scott, there's a direct correlation between voices. This is temporal experiment number one. If you take Dr. Emmett Brown and teach him karate, you get Hong Kong Fooey, number one super guy. Give him a British accent and you get John Hurt. Take away the accent and bring it down to a little more controlled area and you get Alec Baldwin, who if you drop down in tone to almost here, it's Christian Bale as Batman, and you take it down to almost a whisper and it becomes Jack Palance. Actually, I think it's Eastwood, Bunk. Wheel,
go ahead, make my voice.
Well, that depends on your definition of the word voice, because if you give mine a surfer twang, you get Nicolas Cage, who always seems to start a sentence here, but by the end, he's really hot and way up here! You know, he's kind of crazy like, Frank Caliendo doing John Madden,
or Dana Carvey doing Regis Philbin. He's out of control!
Not gonna do Dana Carvey doing George Bush Sr. with me, Prudent. Not gonna do that. I'm gonna do Dana Carvey doing Johnny Carson. Of course, if I want to do the real Johnny Carson, I gotta drop my voice down in tone to right about there, right? Hi-oh, or is it actually, you hear me, right? It's not Johnny Carson, love, it's Johnny Depp, who sometimes a pirate, other times he's, oh, a chocolatier, oh, this is making me madder than a hatter, Alice.
Oh, that's funny with the madder and the hatter and the,
whoa, funny how? Funny like a clown, like I'm here to amuse you, huh? Because I'm not a clown. I'm a chicken hawk, and you're my chicken.
No, boy. I say you got it all wrong, son. I'm not a chicken. I'm a
therapist, boy. What you need is to check up from the neck up, because it's an inconvenient truth that life is like a box of chocolates. Oh, chocolates are cool. I like the ones with the peanut. Yeah. Ooh, ah, ah, hey, yo. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ooh, ah, ooh, that's how it starts. And then there's running and screaming.
It's like me in a relationship. It's very bad. You know, it's like, oh, army playing you in a relationship.
Oh, sweet. Oh.
Either way, it's a no-win situation. I'm Albert Brooks. You're Jay Baruchel. What's the difference in the voice? I don't know. Move them sideways, and you get Paul Giamatti.
Or is it Paul Reiser? You know what I'm saying? You know, really? But the real question is, who are these people? Zoinks like Hey Scoob. All these crazy voices, like, blend together.
Ha ha! Hee hee! Oh!
Yeah, it's tricky. Tricky it is, yes. Near and far. Right, Ricky, did you say tricky? Because I gotta tell you, oh, I get no respect at all. Oh, yeah, but if I did, that'd be great, Gazoo. Yabba dabba, doop, doop.
Oh, Mary. Murray, Lou, oh, I must say, this whole thing is driving me mental. Oh, Shazbot, oh, man, oh, Nanu, Spock, Scotty, Sulu,
Judy,
Jane, get me off this crazy thing,
lady, with the thing in the flavin and the hoigin,
heavens to Murgatroyd, exit stage left even,
humana,
blah, ho,
well, alrighty then, bring it around town. Okay. You know, as a matter of fact, we got a great show for you tonight, but that's all the time we have, so that's all, folks.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Ah, come on. Thank you.
Well, now I'm impressed. However, I think it wise to wrap it up and end on this high note. You know, spending time with you, James, has made time with Anakin seem almost dull. Oh, it appears my transmission is breaking up. James, I better say goodbye to all of you now, and may the Force be with you. Always.
Okay, may the Force be with you as well, Obi-Wan. Well, that is going to be some crazy long-distance bill. I wonder how they calculate that. I don't know. Okay. Have you guys had fun? This is the end of mine, and this is the part, go ahead, where, you know, I get to talk about things in a different perspective, because my life, it was not this. When I grew up, I never knew my father, and I never knew why I was different than everybody else in my family, height, look, everything different, and I never knew why I wanted to do all this, and I just knew it was in here, and I had to do it. I just had to do it. I want to do it. I want to entertain people. I want to make them laugh. I want to make people happy. I want to just make you all happy and feel like you got the best and the most out of each experience in life. And a few years back, about 7 years ago, I got hit with something right when my career was right at its peak. I was doing Ninja Turtles and Johnny Test and Obi-Wan and all the Fred Flintstones, all that started. And my wife and I, we were about to adopt our daughter from China. And we bought this house that was gonna be the place where we raised her and start our family. And it was a money pit. And it just had everything wrong. Electrical, gas leaks, everything you can imagine. And we had black toxic mold in the walls. And I'm the one that found them. And I got exposed to it. And it took something that I could never imagine it would take. It took my voice. I came down with such massive laryngitis and throat infections for months. And it took 2 years to get my voice back to where it was. And I wasn't expecting that. I wasn't expecting it. I thought, hey, everything's great. And that's actually why I want to talk to you all. Every single person in this room has a dream that they have held on to, and sometimes you're going to let go of it. And I want to tell you right now, please, 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 please don't let go of your dream, okay? It's gonna get hard, you're gonna hit walls, you're gonna get obstacles, but you can do it. If I can stand up here, 5'4", 112 pounds, soaking wet, and do a bunch of voices like Fred Flintstone, you can do whatever, because you are all amazing. You have been created to be amazing, so do amazing things. You don't have to change the world, you have to change your world. And so, if you've got friends here today, get your friends to be encouraged, and encourage them back. You can just, you know, you can do it. You can grab on to those dreams and take them and go with them in places you never have. And you're gonna get hitting obstacles, okay? You're gonna hit them. Use them to make you stronger. If this didn't happen, I wouldn't have been where I am now. I had to change my diet, my life, the water, everything I ate and drank. I had to change all of it. But you know what? I'm so much of a better person now for doing it, and I've learned so much more. So take those obstacles, embrace them, love them, cherish them, and make a better life for yourself and all the people around you. I know all of you can do it. And remember, you heard a lot of people here today, but it was all simply one man. One throat, but it was
many voices. You have been witness to the vocal daredevil, the magician of mimicry, the little guy with the big voice in the little padded room.
Talking to myself. God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Scram, 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 scram